Today I am going to present some of the details of the Android security. Yeah, the agenda for today's session is cross-cut scripting. What is cross-cut scripting? What are the types of cross-cut scripting? I will demonstrate one of the attack in refrigerated cross-cut scripting. Then I will go to the privilege escalation attack on Android. Then we will conclude it. What is XSS? XSS means cross-cut scripting. It's a vulnerability found in web application. What it does is, with this vulnerability, the attacker can execute his own code onto the victim PC and steals the private data of his victim PC from his victim PC and sends to the attacker. Like, he can log in it, he can steal the cookies, he can get the details of his private data. What are the cause of this? The cause of this is improper invalidation of the input of the user by the server. Usually, the people who are developing the websites are not aware of the security. So what happens is they does not validate the input. So this acts as a vulnerability for the cross-cut scripting. There are three types of cross-cut scripting: refrigerated XSS, persistent XSS, and DOM-based cross-cut scripting. Yeah, we can view the diagram here. So it clearly shows that he is the attacker. He will design a URL with a malicious code in it in one or more parameters of the URL and sends it to the victim through mail or some other source. When he receives this URL, you just click on it, the request will be sent to the some legitimate site. See, the legitimate site may not be designed by a security aware developers. So because of this improper validation of input, it process the request and sends back the response. In response, the malicious code will be embedded by the server, which they got from the request, and the malicious code will be executed onto the browser and it steals the private data and sends to the attacker. What is the main cause of refrigerated XSS? Again, the improper validation of input is the main cause of refrigerated XSS. So the attacker embeds the malicious code in the parameters of the request. The server reflects the parameter value in the response without validating it. Okay. Now just go through this URL. See, there is a web page in cse.iit.ac.in which is developed by us. So there is a vulnerability. What this page does is it takes one parameter called as name. It doesn't validate the parameter value and just reflect back to the user. Okay. Now just see, attacker has sent a mail to us saying that please click on this link. See, this is a web page. When you click on it, it sends a request to CSC website. There is a page called as test.php with a parameter name and there is some parameter value. So if I click on it, what happens is a request is sent to test.php. See, for example, if I send the same request with the parameter as books, what happens is the result for books came here. Okay. Instead, the request, now the parameter is a malicious code. The parameter value is a malicious code. Now you can see here, you can find here, refused of execution a JavaScript source code of script found within request. That means what happens is this malicious code is sent to the server. Server is not validating the input and it sends back to the client. But the Chrome has a defensive mechanism which doesn't execute this type of scripts. We just view the source. We can view the source of this page. See, it clearly shows the, in response there is a script. Which is alerting saying hi. Okay. If I demonstrate the same thing in the Aakash browser, that is Android native browser, we will see what will happen. See, I got a mail, I am just clicking on it. When I click on it, a request is sent to the same site and the script is executed. So that means the Android native browser doesn't avoid this type of XSS. It is vulnerable to this type of XSS. Whereas when request is sent from this Chrome browser, it gets the same response, but it finds the script in one of its parameter and stops execution. That means Android Chrome has a defensive mechanism called as XSS auditor, which avoids some type of cross-cut scripting. It sits between HTML parser and JavaScript engine and interrupts all the JavaScript request and see whether it is found in one or more parameters. If it is found in the parameters, it stop executing it. Now there is a very native, very navy attack. That is, it doesn't steal any of the private data. Now we can find this URL where a sensitive data is stored. See, there is a legitimate.com. That means it's a genuine site, but it is developed by developers who are not aware of security, which take one parameter. Okay, they are not invalidating the parameter, so the attacker may write script tag where you want to write something. That is document dot, means in the response when this script is executed, it is trying to write some data. They want to write an image whose source is attacker.com. That means they will fetch a data from attacker.com site and write onto the browser window. But while sending a request to the attacker.com, they are even sending the cookie value. That is the reason, with the help of this type of vulnerabilities, the attacker can view the victim, they can get the private data of the victim. Then what is persistent XSS? In persistent XSS, what are the malicious codes which you are sending by the attacker will be stored on the server pages itself. That is, the web page is not developed such a way that, like, just like discussion forums, they are not invalidating the input the user is giving. With the help of this, the attacker will write a malicious code in the discussion forum pages and it sends a request. That means it will be stored in the server itself. Whenever a victim view that pages, he downloads the malicious code and executes it. Yeah, this is the persistent access. That means he is filling some form, something like in discussion forums, and sending a request to the server. The server is not validating the input, so it will be stored in the server itself. And in response, whenever a legitimate user like victim views that pages, the malicious code will be downloaded and it will be executed in the server, and the sensitive data may send it to the attacker. And the third type of cross-cut scripting is DOM-based cross-cut scripting. That means the web pages are nowadays are developed in such a way that some default parameters of the page are taken. We'll go through this script. See, this is a legitimate page where what is doing is it taking a default parameter from the user and taking the value of it, and in the response, this script will be executed in the client side itself. The script will be sent in the response, and in the client side, the victim browser executes this script. What it does is it takes the default value of the request and embed that into the response. See, if this default value is some English, then it doesn't matter. But if this is script, this itself is a script, then this script executes at the client and embeds this script again. Again, when this script is executed, it may be malicious script, so it may steal sensitive data. So there is difference between reflected XSS and DOM-based XSS. Here, what happens is the legitimate script from the server executes and embeds the another script in the response. Now I'll go to the second part of the presentation, that is privileged escalation attack. That is, Android doesn't deal with transitive privilege users. For example, Android applications have components, right? One component can talk to another component through inter-component communication, right? So each component can be used by some other components. We can give the privilege saying that this component can be used by only some type of components. Say, for example, if there is a application C, and it has one component called as C1. C1, if it is protected by label P1, what it means is this C1 component can be only used by applications whose privileges are have P1, right? Once again, I am repeating, if there is application called as C and it has a component called as C1, and if that component C1 is protected by label C1, what it means is any application can use this component C1 if and only if that application have a privilege called as P1. For example, if that component is protected by P1, P2, then it means is this application, this component can be only used by any application whose privileges is P1 and P2. Yeah, this is the Android contains separate modules called as components. Components communicate through a mechanism called as inter-component communication, ICC. And Android has a, it's borrowed, Android isolates applications. It can only access the files only it wants, and it cannot access the files of other thing. Each will have an application ID, just like UID in user ID in the Linux. Okay, what happens in privilege escalation attack? The permissions of an application get escalated at runtime. What usually means in Android, whenever you want to install an application, before installation, it will ask for set of permissions. In the set of permission, it will say that I need internet permission, I need to access contacts, I need to access email, something like that. At the time of installation, if you select all the permissions and install, that is the only thing they are using. But with the help of privilege escalation attack, the privileges which are not granted at the runtime can be escalated. The type of attacks ranges from unauthorized phone calls, SMSs, illegal downloads of malicious files and executing it. What is the vulnerability in privilege escalation attack? That is, an application with less privileges, that is a non-privileged caller, is not restricted to access components of a more privileged caller. I will more explain it in the next slide. We'll go through this diagram. There are three applications in it, application A, B and C, and there are two components in each application, CA1, CA2 in application A and CB1 and CB2 in application B. In the same way, CC1 and CC2 in application C. Application has no granted permissions, that is the granted permission for application A is null. In the same way, the granted permission for application B is only P1. In the same way, the granted permission for application C is null. Okay, you can see that component C1 is protected by label called as P1. That means this component can be called by any component of another application, provided that application has privileged P1. With the help of this statement, can CA1 use its CC1? No, because the protection label says that it can be only used by a component which application have a privilege P1, but A doesn't have privilege P1. So whenever CA1 want to access CC2, it is denied. In the same way, for example, if CB1 want to access CC1, yes, it is granted. The reason is the protected label is P1. This application B has a protected label, granted permission as P1, hence this can use this. Android works well in this manner, that is it deals with the direct dependencies, but whereas in indirect calling, say if CA1 will call CB1, as it's valid. The reason is it is protected by null, that is it can be accessed by any component. So CA1 can access CB1, but CB1 in turn can access CC1. In this way, CA1 can indirectly call CC1, whereas it directly cannot call CC1. That means Android doesn't bother about the transitive dependencies. In this way, we can use this vulnerability, and we can make unauthorized calls, SMS, and we can use all the contacts and may send to the attacker. Then, what is the conclusion? No, there should be a support from the client side to prevent Kafka scripting. All Kafka scripting cannot be avoided with only server validation. There are some type of attacks where they need a need of client side to prevent excesses. As we have discussed in the Chrome, there is an excesses auditor which sits between HTML parser and JavaScript engine and interrupts all the requests, all these JavaScript requests, and see whether it is part of any parameter of the request, and if so, it denies it to execute. Whereas if it phones it is a legitimate request. So you can see here the request is JavaScript request is denied by the XSS auditor in Chrome, whereas in Android native browser it is executed, the script is executed even if it is found in the one of the parameter value. And to avoid the privilege escalation attack in Android, there should be a centralized model where all the requests for the interrupts ICC should go through this, and this should monitor indirect dependencies so that we can avoid the privilege escalation attack at runtime. And these are the references.